Hi there, everyone. Let's talk about fundamentalism. The premise of fundamentalism is that there is an unknowable or uncognizable absolute, and therefore an absolute truth which comes from it. And that there is a state of pure being, egolessness, and so on, oneness with God, with everything, that comes along with that. If you can realize it, then you're free. The problem is they set it up in such a way that no one can realize it. Oh, unless you happen to be at the top of the org chart. So, let me give you an example. Today, I was chatting with a follower of Osho. He's some kind of executive in one of the Osho centers up in Nepal, which I visited. And they wouldn't even let me in without paying a large fee, joining one of their programs, staying at their place, and I couldn't even come in there unless I paid a lot of money. Now, I've been with Osho since, 1980-something? No, 79. And then when he came to Oregon, I went there up to 84. I was with him there. So this is a guy who joined, 2 or 3 years ago, and he's telling me, I can't criticize. I can't say anything because I don't know what's going on there. Well, of course I don't know what's going on there. You won't let me in. And the people who actually might know something, the senior teachers, you can't get to them. There is no access. They do not respond to messages, emails, phone calls, anything like that. They always give you to some staff member. So you can't actually talk. Even if you're a senior sannyasin, you can't talk to the people in charge without paying money. Am I the only one who thinks there's something wrong with this? They call it a commune. But actually, it's a privately owned business. So they're just deceiving everybody. It's like obvious right on the face of it that they're so-called Oshos. Oh, and now they're not even Swamis anymore. Now they're Oshos. Huh? They offered me the title too. And now there's Bodhisattva Oshos. So I said, well, what's next? God Oshos? God Swamis? Huh? Now then it's become non-different from Advaita monism. See? And for everything I had to say, he said, well, Osho says this. They have become just like the fundamentalist Christians always quoting from the Bible, or the fundamentalist Hare Krishnas always quoting from the Gita, or the fundamentalist whatevers always quoting from the whatever they follow or whoever they follow. But they themselves don't have anything to say. And they're really appealing to authority. They're saying, this authority, so-and-so, Mr. Master Bodhisattva Osho Swami Ding Dong, whatever his name is, said so. Or this book says so. Or that source says so. Or it has been revealed. Or the Pleiadians, that's a good one. The Pleiadians said so. God said so. See, it's right here in this book. So they have become non-different. But why is fundamentalism catching on now that even the Osho Swamis are doing this nonsense? Well, I like what David Chapman says about it. He's got a nice analysis. I posted something on Facebook about it this morning. He says, fundamentalism is actually a reaction to modernism and postmodernism. So you could say that fundamentalism is a reactionary movement against modernism, which is the creation of systems, and postmodernism, which is the deconstruction of all systems. It's not a coincidence that fundamentalism started getting really big all over the world around the 1980s. Because by that time, the meaning and significance of all existing systems had been broken, fractured, fragmented into a pointillistic mishmash of all kinds of different incompatible beliefs and teachings. I mean, just take a look at the internet. You have all these point-like fragments of meaning. Nothing is in context, so you don't really know what the meaning is. Instead, we let people tell us what the meaning is and express their opinions about what the meaning is, but nobody really knows. That confidence has been lost. Because why? In the beginning of self-realization, we have no experience. We have no realization. We've heard about this thing, self-realization, and how wonderful it is. And it is wonderful. Anyone who tastes even a little drop of it is going to come back for more. But now there's a business model around it. The business model is, let's build this organization. And we'll have a core team, and they can live for free in the commune, and everybody else gets charged. Or the monastery, or the church, or whatever it is, the mosque, or whatever. There's the core team, the people who are propagating the belief system. And then there's everybody else, the customers. And the customers have to pay. It's a business. Fundamentalism is a business model based on, first, deconstructing all prior sources of truth, and then creating a new one. See? In other words, for example, the Muslim fanatic fundamentalists are saying, actually, the previous generations misunderstood the Quran. All they have isn't Quranic at all. It's simply obsolete village customs, long overdue to be replaced by a system. And we have the system. We know how to interpret the Quran because we go back to the original understanding of the Quran and not this more modern, perverted, localized understanding. I mean, it's natural, and you see it throughout history, that as a religion propagates to different cultures, areas of the world, and so on, it acquires local color. For example, I'll give you an example. A century ago, there was no such thing as a hijab. Or maybe only in some very, very isolated areas, Saudi Arabia. And there, it had some utility because they're living in a desert. But actually, there were many, many different kinds of Muslim dress for ladies. Now, the hijab is the style. Huh? It's ugly. It's horrible. But it has become the standard style. This is an act of fundamentalism. They're saying, no, your colorful ethnic costumes and local culture is no good. Only our interpretation of the meaning of Quran is true because we go back to the original meaning, not the one that got changed as Muslim beliefs propagated throughout the world. You can apply this to any religion. Buddhism is the same. Buddhism underwent a Protestant Reformation in the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century in Japan, Burma, Sri Lanka, and Tibet. They all adapted their beliefs to systemize and standardize the interpretation of their scriptures. Why? To keep up with modernity. Specifically, to reply to colonialism and Christian fundamentalism, but Christian fundamentalism hadn't been invented yet. Christian proselytizing and conversion in their countries. So Buddhism has also changed. Christianity, of course, has changed drastically. Fundamentalism and what were those things called? Charismatic cults? Yeah. Pretty much took over Christianity. And of course, they're really good at taking things out of context and applying their own interpretations, which of course are all based on some authority or other. So, fundamentalism is bunk. Why? Because all systems are bunk. No system can accurately, comprehensively describe reality, what the speaker predicted. It's been tried so many times. This is why postmodernism became very popular. Now, why were these systems developed in the first place? Because the modern age demanded it, one thing. Another thing is, the system is not the truth. The system is only a map. And usually it's a map of practice. You say this mantra, you do that ritual, you sit in this posture, you reflect or meditate in this way, and so on. See? And then the system is simply an elaborate network of rationalizations and explanations as to why. The modern age deconstructed traditionalism by asking why. A traditional tribal approach to life is choiceless. There are no alternatives. There is simply the way. You're born into it, you're educated into it, trained up in it, you grow up in it, and you live it your whole life. There is no choice. There is no other way. That's simply the way it is. But then, globalism introduced contact between different cultures, different tribals. And that means somebody is going to start saying, why do you do it this way? Why don't you do it that way? We do it. We always done it that way. Oh, but we always did it this way. And then they fight, right? So the real thing is the system only exists to prop up the practice. The system in itself is practically worthless. It's a door. It's a method. It's a device, a trick. But if you start thinking the system is the thing, you miss. You completely miss any opportunity at self-realization. Why? Because the map is not the territory. The system is not the realization. We're after the realization, not the system. The knowledge is chump change. The knowledge is the booby prize. The knowledge is what you get if you fail to attain realization. So you have a bunch of people following all these systems, and then postmodernism comes along and says, no, wait a minute, Facebook, Twitter, the atomization of meaning. With systems, meaning was fractured into this system, that system, the other system. Now it's becoming atomized. It's becoming a fine spray of particles of meaning, taken out of context, which means actually they're meaningless. Or the context is the consensus culture, which pretty much sucks for everybody. So what's the answer? A return to tribalism? That's what they're doing in the Middle East. But because it's fundamentalist, it's reactionary. It's not going to work. Actually, nothing works. Nothing can work. The only thing that can work is if you do the process, if you do the sadhana, if you do the method, whatever it is, bhakti or Christianity or yoga or meditation or whatever it is, do it. Don't think about it. Don't argue about it. Don't make words about it. Do it. Get the result. The system, the knowledge, the words, asking why, are only good if they get you to do the practice. It's sales talk. Huh? It's sales talk. This here is the best little used car on this lot. I'll tell you, the little old lady who had it only drove to church on Sunday morning. That's why the miles are so low. And that transmission, man, doesn't that feel sweet? Then you get the thing home and you find out the odometer's been rewound and the transmission's full of sawdust and the oil is full of STP. You bought a lemon, right? It's sales talk. This is the best religion. This is the best philosophy. This is the best whatever. But if you actually try it, meh. So the only way to really know if you have found a truth is to try it. Put it into use. Put it into practice. Then, see if it works for you. That's why there are so many methods, because there are so many different types of people. My method, Shibari Zen, isn't the truth. And it certainly isn't the absolute truth. It's just a method for people who like bondage. If you like bondage, you'll love Shibari Zen. You can even attain enlightenment through it. Great. If you don't like bondage, then forget it. It's not going to work. That's why I only want to deal directly, personally, one-on-one with people who are of the same opinion, the same type. You have a different type, you go to a different teacher. I'm done with giving systems. I gave so much instruction on the Buddhist system, and I actually realized it. And then what? The Buddhists kicked me out. They made the campaign of silence, the conspiracy of silence. You know, and I regularly get threats in my inbox from Buddhists, from Hindus who are practicing love of God. Well, if they really had love of God, they would love all God's creatures. And this rationalization of, well, we're really helping everybody by suppressing these teachings that aren't the truth, is bullshit. I'll call it for what it is. It's bullshit. Now, what does this have to do with post-enlightenment? Well, pre-enlightenment, you're looking for the path. You're searching everywhere, trying this, trying that. And then somebody comes along and they look like they really got it, you know, whatever that means to you. The key fits your lock somehow or other, huh? They push your buttons. And so you approach that person as a teacher, as a master, and you follow their teaching. And either it works or it doesn't. Or maybe it works part of the way and then it doesn't work the rest of the way. That's what happened to me. I've had so many teachers and so many masters. And, you know, some of them were enlightened. But none of them could give me an actual practical method to go the whole way of the path. None of them. Even Rajneesh, Osho, who I have in such high esteem, couldn't get me to fourth path. He got me to first path. Yeah, 1984. But it took me until just a year ago to reach fourth path. And I had to go deep into the Buddhist suttas. If you've seen any of my series on enlightenment, you see just how far I've gone into those suttas. But the last master I had, Bhikkhu Jñānānanda, he taught me one thing in three words. And that resulted in my getting third and fourth path. He said, Nibbana is non-conceptual. Now, if you're ready to hear that, like I was, when I went to see him, I had been meditating 10, 12 hours a day for a couple of years in monasteries. And I went to see him, and he said that to me. Boom! I went right into a deep trance. And he just went on talking with the other visitors as if nothing was going on. Although I think he did use some body language to indicate that I was getting it. But I took that home with me, and I continued to meditate on it and research it until I got it. Nibbana is non-conceptual. See, you don't know what's going to cause your enlightenment. It could be anything. You know that wonderful story of the disciple who goes to the master and he's serving him and rubbing his feet and stuff like this. And then time for him to go home. It's very dark out, no moon. So he says, "Master, can I have a light?" So the master gives him a lamp or a candle or something. And just as he's about to turn and go out the door, suddenly the master blows the flame out. Boom! Instant enlightenment. Does that mean if you go to Japan and you go to a master with a candle and let him blow it out that you're going to become enlightened? Duh. No. What it does mean is that particular individual at that moment needed that particular catalyst to realize. And you don't know what it's going to be. And, you know, I don't even think the masters know what it's going to be. It just comes up. It just arises spontaneously in the moment. And of course, the master is realized, so he acts spontaneously without thinking. Boom. He says or does something. One guy in Japan got enlightened after being thrown out of a second-story window. It's slapstick Zen humor, huh? But it worked. Somehow it worked. So, I mean, who am I to say? What do I know, right? Maybe going to a commercial place and paying a lot of money to be able to sit there with someone who's imitating Osho is going to make you enlightened. I don't know. Maybe it's possible. But I think it's more likely that if you actually approached a self-realized soul, somebody who's not in the business, who's not a professional, who does it for love, then you might have some better results. That's just my opinion. Of course, I'm old-fashioned. I'm a traditionalist. I follow the Wu Wei, the choiceless path, pathless path. So I don't believe in all of this step-by-step stuff. Even though I went through it in the past, now that I'm realized, I see that it's not real. It's a device. It's not like the map is absolute. It can never be absolute because the map is not the territory. The description is not the thing. The word is not the object it represents. So what's real? What's actually real is that somehow we have to find the motivation to practice. And of course, Osho was a great trickster. He liked to joke. He liked to mess around. He liked to pull people's threads, tweak their buttons, just to show them that they still have them. But these modern followers of Rajneesh, they have adopted the external part of his method, but they haven't got the internal part, which is that during the silences, something very profound is shared. Emptiness, silence, nothing. So I'm wondering now, because after my enlightenment, after fourth path, I found myself unable to participate anymore in organizations. So I'm wondering how this is going to play out. If some really sincere people came to me and wanted to work together and like that, I don't know how I could say no. But at the same time, I really don't believe in these organizations. And I especially don't believe in an organization that profits from exploiting people's hunger for enlightenment. See, all the churches, all the temples, all the mosques, all these guys are profiting from people's hunger because they're lost. They don't know what to do. Meaning is fragmenting around them in the society. All the systems are falling apart, being proved wrong by skeptical postmodernism, and there's nothing they can do about it. So they feel like meaning, significance is slipping away from them. So they want something to steady their life, to solidify their ideas and thinking and so on, to give them some motivation, some hope. Of course, this is all bogus. This is all of the mind. But still, there is a demand for a product. Of course, the market is going to rise up to service that demand. You know, you pick some good-looking guy who speaks well, and he's got that certain lean, elite look, and you dress him in some funny robes, and he starts talking in a funny way about reality and consciousness and emptiness. Ah, isn't it beautiful? And sentimental, stupid people are going to buy it every single time. Oh yeah, all I have to do is give you money? Oh, that's great. I mean, this is the business model of the Roman Catholic Mafia since forever. Just give me money, I'll take care of your spiritual problems. Don't worry, I'll talk to the boss. I'll talk to the boss, we'll take care of it, all right? Yeah, just give me your money. Look, I grew up in the middle of the Sopranos in New Jersey, right? That's why I got this funny accent. You don't like the way I talk? You know, take a hike. Because that was the business model. It's the mafia, la familia, the family. You can't join it if you're not part of it. And if you are, you can't leave it. It's your family. And if you screw up, they're going to whack you. And if you need somebody whacked, just go down to the capo, you know? That means the leader, the head of the family. Number one, numero uno, the capo. The beginning, the origin, the root. If he approves it, that person gets whacked. If the Dalai Lama approves it, I get whacked. See? That's the way it works. It's a mafia. So, don't go to organizations and don't share your resources with them. They're selling you a bill of goods. They're exploiting you, exploiting your hunger, your neediness, your ignorance, your lack. If you actually read what Osho says, if you actually understand what he's saying, you would never join his organization. You might come as a guest. But even then, you're going to get exploited. You're going to get exploited. Because that's the business model. And it's been that way for thousands of years. So don't participate in religion. Remain an individual, but don't listen to everything you hear either. I'll tell you my secret formula. When I decide to learn something, whatever it is, it could be type of meditation, or it could be a new technology or a sport. I'll do a survey of the field, and I'll sample everybody, and I'll find the one person who looks like they really know what they're talking about and who can walk their talk, who can do the things they say. And then I just take everything I can find by that one person and read it, think over it, digest it, and do it, practice it, until I get a result. Or not. And if I don't, it means either it was bogus or I didn't understand it properly. So you have a choice to make. You can support these various organizations, or you can simply start walking. Take up the path for yourself. Try all these different methods. Find out what works for you. And if you find someone who seems to know what they're talking about, approach that person. Serve him. You will not get it unless you do this service, unless you find a guru and serve him, love him. It can't be a long distance thing. It has to be up close and personal. That's the only way it works. That's what worked for me anyway. What I got from my teachers was because I went there and served them, not because I read their books and stuff like that. That was just the appetizer. The main course is you go to a guru, you shut out all this noise from the world, from the marketplace. Okay, you already did your window shopping, you already selected a guru, you already selected a method, now you're committed. You go to that person and absorb their being. That's the key. That's the secret.